to explore some of that with you. Firstly, in the course of your opening statement, Mr. Sough, and at different points you question the credibility of the CNAG. Now, this is an echo of what Frank Daly had to say when he was before us. Mr. Sough, you yourself have been a public servant for your entire career. You are aware that the Office of the Comptroller and Auditor General is a constitutional office. You are aware that he and the staff in the office carry out their work without fear or without favour, and that at all times they exercise due diligence. Can you confirm that you accept that?
I don't agree that we have questioned, the way you put it, credibility. We have a professional disagreement on certain things. I fully agree. In my lengthy public service career, I dealt with the local government audit service, and I didn't have particularly difficult relations with that service, and I very much respect the two services, the Controller and Auditor General Service and the Local Government Audit Service. They perform.
Can I stop you there, Mr. Yeah. Sough, and just say that today is not the first occasion on which the defence of NAMA has been premised not on substantiated facts from yourself, but on what I regard as an outright assault on the Office of the Comptroller and Auditor General. Can I give you an example of this from the point directly from your statement today at page 7, where you make the following assertion, that the CNAG's view on the management of conflict of interests reflects a subjective opinion exercised with hindsight by the CNAG. That is an extraordinary remark to make. It questions not just the competence, but in fact the diligence or even indeed the integrity of the Office of the CNAG. I think you have no basis for making this assertion.
I don't accept that, Deputy.
Well, then what is meant by that statement?
What we're saying really is that we are being judged on what is known about the gentleman concerned in 2016 against what we when we were dealing with the problem, what we knew in 2014.
Right, we'll come back to that in a moment. I don't accept that, but we'll come back to that. At another point, let me bring you to page 6. You say that the board rejects the CNAG's unsubstantiated suggestion that serious credible bidders were excluded from the process. So you assert here not simply that people were excluded, but the unsubstantiated suggestion, as you put it. And again, in so stating, you question the due diligence and the integrity of the Office of the CNAG. That's my interpretation of that statement.
That's not mine.
Okay. Can I put it to you, Mr. Sough, that we've had some witnesses before us. We will hear from more. But one thing marks out the CNAG and the report in that every assertion that is made, whether you accept the assertion or not, is fully substantiated. And unlike yourselves, is actually backed up with what was an extensive trawl and consideration and examination of the material available to the office from NAMA.
Deputy, I wouldn't agree with that, with your comment that everything was substantiated by the CNAG, because at the fundamental point that I believe is at issue here is the discount factor which was applied, and I don't believe that has been substantiated.
Sorry, Mr. McHenry, I didn't make reference to the discount factor.
But it is a key factor.
There has been quite a substantial discussion on that. I referenced in particular the issue of conflicts of interest and the issue of exclusion of credible bidders.
Well, our view, quite simply, is that all credible bidders who could write a cheque for 1.3 billion euro, pound sterling, had the opportunity to bid.
And I'm sure you also accept that within the report of the CNAG, views are given from other bidders who found the process to be unsatisfactory, to say the least of it. They raise a series of concerns. Their concerns, simply recorded by the CNAG, in terms of valuations, in terms of the very obvious fact that PIMCO had a head start on all other comers. I'm sure you've read those criticisms in the report. You're surely not suggesting that the CNAG invented these concerns. You accept at a minimum that these concerns were expressed by other bidders or potential bidders.
Give different reasons why they shouldn't continue. A range of reasons. If they were serious contenders, determined to buy the portfolio, they'd stay in the race.
So what I'm trying to get to, Mr. Soff, is your acceptance of the facts as reflected by the CNAG, that a number of bidders and potential bidders were less than happy with the process that NAMA ran. Can you accept that?
I fully accept that he gives the accurate account of why people withdrew, which there are several reasons given throughout
throughout the text. Therefore, his assertions and observations are substantiated.
The point we are making is that apart from the nine, there didn't seem to be other people out there.
And that's not the question that I put to you. I am putting it to you that you have made a very serious charge against a constitutional office of this state, that a report produced by that office was based on unsubstantiated suggestions, and any reading of the report does not support that description.
I and my colleagues on the board and the chairman and the chief executive here the last day have consistently said, and we believe it, that all credible bidders had the opportunity to bid.
That's not the question. I'm affording you an opportunity, Mr. Soff, and your colleagues, to withdraw what I think is very intemperate language and an assertion over which you could not possibly stand, that the CNAG, whatever your difference around conclusions, to suggest that matters are unsubstantiated in this report is just wrong. And I would suggest that you avail of the opportunity to withdraw that particular set of remarks in your opening statement.
Well, what we said, what it simply means is there aren't other people there who were interested in bidding. Who else was there apart from the nine?
But the report contains criticisms of the sales process. You have accepted that, have you not, Mr. Soff?
No, I haven't.
It's there, black on white. We will hear, I'm sure, in the course of our hearings, perhaps from some of these bidders, and they may come in to reiterate their concerns with the process.
I mean, bidders are bidders, and I'm not sure.
I'm not asking you to...
Lazarus has told us that this was a properly run process. And that's what we accept.
Well, I think you're deliberately not. I'm sure you take my point. I hope you take my point, particularly you, Mr. Soff. You've made reference to your record in public service. You do not lightly come before an Oireachtas committee and attempt to question or trash the office of the Comptroller and Auditor General, a constitutional office.
I'm not trashing, and I wouldn't do that.
You might.
What we are saying is we're defending our position.
And in so doing, attacking, I think, rather unjustly and in an unfounded way. You've made another assertion in the course of this morning, gentlemen, and that relates to PIMCO and the manner of their withdrawal from the sales process. And my colleague, Deputy Cullinan, raised this with you earlier. You have suggested that PIMCO, having discovered these unethical, inappropriate success fees or finder's fees, attempted to get the acquiescence of NAMA for that. That is your position.
Would have liked to stay in the process, yes.
The minutes reflect that, to your narrative, NAMA, or PIMCO sought the acquiescence of NAMA. Is that still your position? That yes. That's what. Do you understand the seriousness of making that assertion?
It's what would I expected them to do. Can we stay? You know, let's be clear about it. Success fees are quite common. Our problem was that they were paying, being suggested that they would be paid to people who were associated with us.
And, Mr. Suff, the very reason why PIMCO approached NAMA and not vice versa was because they had unearthed this fact. And for them, for them, in terms of not just what is ethical, but what is legal and what is in compliance with the regulatory framework, which they are bound to, this caused a massive problem for them. They approached you, not vice versa. We can agree on that,
yes.
Gentlemen.
Oh, yes.
Thank you.
I think, just for clarity, the people who are carrying out the negotiations obviously propose success fees, but their compliance
unit...
I'll
come to that in a moment. The legal compliance unit approach you, we've established that. Your contention is, having approached NAMA in that way, that the legal compliance division of PIMCO then sought to sidestep their regulatory and legal duties in an effort to stay within the process with your acquiescence. That's what you've told us today. Okay.
I think that they quite accepted that it was illegal.
Well, then why did they approach you?
Well, I suppose they saw us as a public authority who had were very tight on this sort of thing, you know, and we have been, our rules are very strict. I mean, there's another rule, for instance, that we can't sell to a debtor. He's back his property.
Can
so, I?
I
mean, they alerted us and, you know, is this okay? And we said, no.
Well, that's not what's reflected in the notes from the conference calls, and that really doesn't tally with common sense, quite frankly, given that PIMCO made the approach to yourselves. PIMCO, to use a term, I suppose, were the whistleblower in this scenario. The contemporaneous notes of the phone calls and the exchanges between PIMCO, their legal and compliance unit, their legal and compliance unit, reflects their concern, their insistence that they would not be party to a process where these fees were involved, and their willingness initially, and then their insistence that they withdraw. Now, that's what I would expect a legal compliance unit to do, but you are suggesting, your minutes intimate, but you were suggesting today that that's actually not what happened, that PIMCO came to you right enough, but they came to you to say, how do we sidestep this? How do we hang in? That's a very, very serious charge to level against PIMCO. Do you understand the seriousness of that, Mr. Self?
I think you need to be clear. There were discussions with the legal and compliance department of PIMCO, and I think there were discussions between the buying team of PIMCO. As a board member, our position was very clear, and the position of the legal and compliance department at PIMCO very clear, that this was a problem. They came to us, they said, we have a problem about this.
But is your position that PIMCO, the legal compliance unit, sought to hang in the process?
I think they were, if there was any way that they could have carried on, that's something that they would have looked at by eliminating all causes of the problem.
Can I just say again that actually the notes from the conference calls completely refute that assertion, Mr. Ellingham. In fact, the conference call dated the 12th of March 2014, PIMCO further stated that it could not see how any change would allow the organisation to continue with the transaction. That suggests that in fact the move to try and change things or sidestep things didn't emanate from PIMCO, but in fact emanated from NAMA.
I don't believe that's the case, in that at no point do I believe the board ever considered.
No.
Ever considered. Yeah, the possibility of letting PIMCO carry on with any taint that we thought was a problem.
Okay, so the conference call on the 11th of March 2014, here we have the head of asset recovery, Ronnie Hanna, I believe, inquiring about other options. And then PIMCO asks him, what does he mean by this? And then the head of asset recovery, Ronnie Hanna, asks if the deal could be shaped differently for the arrangement fee to come out. That's fairly explicit there, gentlemen, that in fact it was NAMA looking to reorder or reshape things and to keep PIMCO in. It doesn't support your assertion.
That wasn't the case. So, all three of us were at the board, and there was never any attempt to keep them in. Never. Well,
what you may have is a situation where we, as the board, in making the ultimate decision whether to proceed or not, would not have condoned that and did not we were not aware of that conversation taking place.
So is it your contention then that Ronnie Hanna acted alone in that regard?
Well, certainly if he was conveying the impression that the board was looking for a way of allowing PIMCO to continue, that was wrong.
The notes that I have quoted from, just for the record, Cathaoirleach, are from summaries of the communications, mainly conference calls between PIMCO and NAMA in March 2014 regarding PIMCO's withdrawal from the Project Eagle loan sales process, and are based on meetings with NAMA officials and the examination team reviewing a minute of a conference call prepared by NAMA's senior divisional manager legal and reviewed by NAMA's head of asset recovery. Based on contemporaneous notes taken by the senior divisional manager legal on the 11th, 12th and 13th of March, and copies of email correspondence between NAMA, legal and PIMCO. So they are substantiated. This is not an unsubstantiated scenario. And what they reflect is in fact NAMA attempting to hold PIMCO inside the process.
Be absolutely clear that at no stage was that an option that the board of NAMA was considering.
Okay, so I can only surmise then, gentlemen, that Mr. Ronnie Hanna, head of asset recovery, and NAMA's senior divisional manager legal were on a solo run in this regard. I can't arrive. That's the suggestion that you're making here. Would that be correct, Mr. Ellinger?
I'm making very clear what the board's position is.
Okay, well, can I say, Cathaoirleach, that we should invite in? I know Mr. Hanna has been invited, but certainly we need to hear from NAMA senior divisional manager legal on this matter. So if we could make a note.
Could
on
I
that.
Just mention one other thing, Deputy, which I think is...
Briefly, Mr. McGinn.
Yeah. We specifically, and I know that I'm just trying to find it here in the minutes, but I specifically, in a subsequent discussion, when Cerberus did emerge, I, because of the fact that we did not want this, and I referred to it earlier on as a proxy, we specifically, I specifically sought assurance that PIMCO were not in the background, that just in case, because for all of the reasons that you've outlined, we did not want this to be ending up with PIMCO through, in effect, the back door, and thankfully that hasn't been the case.
Can I bring you to the board minutes of the 3rd of April? And of course, this is the meeting at which you finally sign off on the deal in respect of Cerberus. And at that point, you discover, or you've asked for confirmation.
Page
120, 121.
Okay, 1-1. Okay, we'll get it up on the screen.
So, mindful of the scenario that had gone before around fixers' fees, you approach Cerberus to get certain comfort from them in respect of fixers' fees. So you are advised that they had agreed a success fee with Brown Rudnick. You would have known Brown Rudnick's role in the previous PIMCO scenario. Following further clarification, you discover that Brown Rudnick had contracted to Toohan Solicitors. I'm sure that name rang a bell. And that the success fee was to be split 50-50 between Brown Rudnick and Toohans. That's how it happened, right? Now, let me just put this to you very, very directly, because you strike me as sensible people, and you certainly have made great play on your personal experiences in the commercial world and how these things run. For me, it is absolutely astonishing that, having heard the names Brown Rudnick and Toohans, that there wasn't an alarm bell or a worry go off in your heads. You knew, for instance, Mr. Soff, that a number of the Northern Committee meetings had happened in Toohans. You were aware of the close relationship between Frank Cushnahan, who had an office in Toohans, and so on and so forth. And when it comes to the moment where you have to call this and make the decision, it strikes me as almost extraordinary that nobody sat back and said, well, hang on a minute, we need to delve a bit deeper. Was the question put to Cerberus in respect of Mr. Cushnahan?
Here, we specifically asked for confirmation from Cerberus that no further fee-sharing of that fee was agreed. And then the head of legal confirmed that Cerberus had confirmed that the potential fee was payable to Toohans and no individual power. So, as far as we were concerned, we had confirmation in writing from Cerberus
that it was not going down the line to anybody else. Did you specifically ask about Mr. Frank Cushnahan? Is there a piece of paper? Was there a phone call? Is it recorded anywhere that questions were asked around Mr. Cushnahan specifically?
I don't know the answer to that, but certainly I know, having been there at the meeting, our clear intention was to sweep up anything that was caught before, like Frank Cushnahan. So whether there's a piece of paper that confirms that, that I don't know. But certainly the fact we use the words of no former or current member or employee of NAMA.
It covered anybody who was a member or a former member of the board, anybody who was a member or former member of any committee, and anybody who was on the staff or who had been on the staff.
That strikes me as remarkably coy on your part.
It's comprehensive.
Why not, in addition to your comprehensive sweep, why not ask specifically about Frank Cushnahan? That's what I would have done if I was on your board. I, as a member of that board, would very specifically have wanted to know, was there any trace or track of Mr. Cushnahan in the midst of this transaction?
Well,
seems to be a bit of a deficit of common sense, gentlemen, if you don't mind me saying.
The assurance we got as covering him, automatically.
Do you still accept that that assurance holds water?
I have no reason to believe that it doesn't.
You know that there are several investigations underway?
Well, maybe.
Not least in this jurisdiction, soon to be established, but in the northern jurisdiction, in America. Like, that wasn't a good day's work by you, was it?
Can I just allude? I found the paragraph, actually. It's page 122 and the second last bullet point, or second last paragraph, sorry. It says, in reference to a question from the board, it was noted that while the preferred, the preferred bidder could, in theory, sell the portfolio onto PIMCO, there was no suggestion that Cerberus was acting as a surrogate purchaser for PIMCO. It wasn't as if the board wasn't. I believe that was me. I asked a question around it because I said, just in case, Remember...
Which, if you don't mind me saying, Mr. McHenry, makes it all the more extraordinary that the direct question wasn't put at any stage in relation to Mr. Cushman.
We got a comprehensive, not just in relation to one person, but in relation to any person, that there was no payments to anybody who had been a current or former member. And the reality of it is that was the assurance that we got. I believe we got that assurance twice.
Could I just come back to the question? I don't know what point, Deputy, you're making about office location. We held meetings in... the practice really was to try and to rotate the meetings between Northern Ireland and here. So we had meetings in Armagh, and then we had meetings in Tuans, in the housing executive, in hotels in Northern Ireland. So, I mean... we had no connections, really, or any...
You think I'm making a big deal over nothing? Is that it? Can I just direct you in that regard to the board's minutes, page 116 and 17, of the 11th of March? And at this stage, the head of asset recovery, Ronnie Hanna, tells you of the conversation with the with PIMCO. And what's fascinating is, as you go through the minute, you say, following discussions, page 117, Caoimhle, the board agreed that there was no specific issue in relation to PIMCO's success fee payments to Brown Rudnick. Okay. Based in London. The board noted that in light of the co-location of offices between Frank Cushnahan and Toohan's solicitors, there were some reservations in respect to a success fee payment to the latter. So actually, this isn't my genius mind at work. In fact, it had occurred to you that there was a problem there. You recognised the relationship, the proximity, let's say, between Mr. Cushnahan and Toohan's. They're your own minutes, Mr. Soft, sorry, aren't they? So what point were you making to me? In fact, that minute goes on, and it says, in light of Frank Cushnahan's involvement in the PIMCO bid, the board discussed whether PIMCO's bid at this stage was fatally flawed, fair enough, given the potential perception that PIMCO might have benefited from insider information as a result of Frank Cushnahan's involvement. So you recognise that there was an issue around the relationship with Toohan's, but more than that, you actually recognise that there was an issue around information that Cushnahan may have had and the effect of that on the bid.
Well, it's not information, a perception that it may have been there.
And how does one tell the dancer from the dance and what's real and what's perceived, Mr. Soff?
But we knew that Cushnahan hadn't had information, because information about individual debtors would come to the board, but not to the Northern Ireland Advisory Committee.
He would have obtained no information from us in relation to individual debtors.
Probably he didn't need it. Sure, he was advising 6-7 debtors that represented 50% of the portfolio. I would suggest to you that he didn't have to come to your meeting necessarily to have extensive debtor information. So you go on then at this meeting, and you say that, yes, the payment to Cushnahan it was a significant issue. You've made a great play on that. But at no stage in any of your documentation is it reflected that you resolved as a board to say, therefore, tell PIMCO, all bets are off, cheerio. And in fact, as we had in an earlier exchange, in fact, the papers tell a very, very different story.
So going back to your page 117, mm-hmm. you've yourself referred to the fact that we described that the PIMCO bid was fatally flawed.
Yes. May have been fatally flawed, yeah.
Then we went on page 118 to say that NAMA would not accede to the arrangement which PIMCO had disclosed to us.
Okay. Here's my point, though. You say that PIMCO tried to manoeuvre to get you on side to something that really shouldn't have been going on. They tried to sidestep compliance and regulation. That's your contention, gentlemen, isn't it? It's a very serious thing to suggest.
I don't think it is something that we as a board were aware was taking place.
Well, it's in your minutes that they tried to get your acquiescence to this dodgy manoeuvre. It's in your minutes.
And it's something that we wouldn't have considered.
Right, well, you're stating to us, we're trying to unravel here, gentlemen, what happened.
Members.
We can only go on the basis of what's in front of us. Your minutes tell us that you discussed it as a board and that it was said, and it's faithfully recorded, that PIMCO were trying to pull a quick one.
Well, what we're saying is that it was not acceptable to NAMA on finding out that a success fee would be payable to Frank Cushnan, who was a former member of the Northern Ireland Advisory Committee. What we are not saying that it was fatally flawed because of a success payment to Toohans or to Brown Rudnick, because success payments are very often part of that sector. What was unacceptable to us was that Frank Cushnan, whom we didn't know prior to that disclosure, was potentially to be in receipt of success. That was unacceptable. That's what made it fatally flawed, and that's what NAMA would not accede to.
And the conversations that we have just gone through in Appendix E comprehensively refute that assertion. That's not the conversations, according to this material, that was had with PIMCO.
What we are clearly saying, as we were three of the, I think it was seven directors, we absolutely recount that we were there when that discussion occurred, and we would not accept the payments, and we would not as a consequence accept that PIMCO could continue in this.
So in other words, Ronnie Hanna and the other person, your senior divisional manager legal, I don't know if you want to tell us who that is or who that was, they were essentially on a solo run. Okay, that's your position on that. We'll come back to that, no doubt.
You're not a position as a board.
Yeah, at future hearings.
Sorry,
Cathal. I'm assuming I can come back in.
You will get a second option.
Okay, but in all of the assertions, and you've been so aggressive in a lot of your assertions and so absolutely dogmatic in them, the difficulty is that when you actually go to the board minutes, and when you examine, for instance, and I'm zeroing in on this issue of PIMCO because I think it's core to how you did your business, and frankly, your own stewardship on the board, this thing that you were insistent as regards PIMCO, that they were to take that, is not reflected in the minutes. There is no record of a decision by the board to say, well, that's the PIMCO bid now finished. And in fact, we've other material that contradicts and casts doubt on it. So, I mean, you stated, Mr. Soff, your obligations under the NAMA Act, and I have no reason to doubt your sincerity in that regard at all, any of you, none whatsoever. But my reading of this material is that at stages you were either, I don't know, half asleep, or you were quite willing to let things go on the by in your haste to get rid of this portfolio.
I don't accept that at all. I repeat what I've said. As a board, the clear message back to PIMCO was that if they had the option of exiting themselves, but there was no way they could continue. And they did exit.
Well, my final question is this. We know they exited. Can I ask you, did your head of legal division report to any regulatory authority at that time or subsequently that PIMCO had attempted to sidestep their regulatory and their legal duties in the way that you contend happened, seeking your acquiescence and so on? Did you report that anywhere?
I'm not aware that we did.
Well, I'm assuming NAMA is in contact with various authorities now in respect of other investigations. Have you made this information known in respect of PIMCO? Did you make a complaint or share that information with any of those investigating authorities?
Well,
I believe we have made declarations to the Standards and Public Office around Mr. Cushnan.
No, I'm asking about your assertions around PIMCO.
No, I'm not aware.
But we haven't, no. I mean, ultimately, we haven't made an assertion around PIMCO.
Oh, you have?
Sorry, we have. What we said is that we would not accept
that they could make
a success-based payment to somebody who was a former participant on the Northern Ireland Advisory Committee. And that's what we have said. And as a consequence of the fact that it is alleged of these payments to our potential payments to Mr. Cushion, we did make a report to the relevant authorities around Mr. Cushion.
You have no. This is an important point, and this is my last one. This shouldn't be missed. You haven't just said that. You have said that PIMCO connived to stay within the process. That's your position on it, that they sought your acquiescence in that regard. That's your position. And I'm a bit astonished because the seriousness of asserting that seems to have gone over your heads. I would imagine that the head of the legal division of PIMCO and PIMCO corporate would not be best impressed or pleased at the suggestion that an entity such as theirs attempted to sidestep regulation and the law. That's what you're asserting here.
What we are asserting is that they sought the agreement for NAMA to accept.
It's the same thing.
Sorry, but what I'm saying is that NAMA did not accept. And NAMA would not accept.
You've made that point, and you're not moving from that position.
But sorry, they sought the agreement to pay success-based fees to whom they had retained. We would not agree in relation to Mr. Cushnan. That is the fact of NAMA's
position. But no, it's more. Sorry, gentlemen, it's more serious than that. They approached you because they knew that a success fee could not go to Frank Cushnan or anybody else associated with it. Hold on a second, Mr. McHenry. They bring this to your attention, and it is now your contention that they said, but listen, whatever about that, how do we hang on in? That is a most serious charge against any organisation and their compliance and legal division. And I'm surprised at that.
I put it slightly differently. You know, if you were PIMCO and you had invested a large amount of money in looking at the assets, doing due diligence and the rest of it, it would be quite natural for you
to try and break the law.
And I'm not saying break now, but was there any way that we could stay in the process?
Okay, going to conclude, we've got
the conversations were with their legal and compliance unit, not with some office junior who thought it might be a bright idea to hang in. And you are asserting, and you've asserted multiple times, that that person charged with legal compliance sought to sidestep or undermine illegal compliance in that regard. That is an astonishing, astonishing claim for you to make. And I'm sure, Cahirlach, we'll have PIMCO here, and we can test
I don't know. But I'm not suggesting that they sought to do an illegal act. But what we're saying is
they sought your acquiescence.
Yeah, but I'm not saying we're not. I'm not. I certainly didn't even ask whether this was a legal or illegal act. And quite frankly, it was not of concern. The fact of it was...
It wasn't of concern.
I'll tell you what was of concern to me, was that I wouldn't have anything to do with it. I wouldn't allow my support go to PIMCO remaining in that process. That was the fact.
Mr. McHenry, do you think the legal and compliance unit of PIMCO was in touch? Because it was an issue of legality and compliance and regulation.
And
that's why they called
you. From the perspective of this board, it didn't get past first base that PIMCO could stay in this. And that's why it was fatally flawed, and we would not acquiesce to it. And both of those are inside in our minutes,
that it was fatally flawed. Can I just say one thing? Yeah. If somebody had been able to demonstrate to me and to us generally that paying the fee was legal, there is no way we would still accept it.
Fine.
Because it was unethical from our point of view that somebody who had been with us was getting paid.
I'm trying to dance around my central point, but your assertion is recorded on the record of the
committee. Deputy, you'll have another opportunity. Deputy Cassatt.
Thanks, Chairman. Thanks to all the gentlemen as well this morning, this afternoon, for the contributions. My colleague, during questioning with the Minister for Finance, made reference to no smoke without fire, which generated plenty of chuckles. But the one thing that's been happening at these meetings is there's been plenty of stoking of the coals. And I suppose every so often little sparks emanate and we get little nuggets of information, but it's taken plenty of stoking to get those nuggets. One of the core points that is ultimately our objective in examining is obviously the issue of a probable loss. Stressed again by Mr. McEnery, on the opinion of your own chair, a good deal. And a Minister for Finance who has wished us well in finding the truth. But what is central here is the question of motivation. Now, Mr. Stoff has said in your opening statement the process would not continue if not competitive. And also said three times that no political pressure was brought to bear. Now, I just want to reflect on what the Minister for Finance said during his time here in front of the PAC, because he was at pains to present what he called, at pains, and he uses a context for what was happening in the overall economy, in the overall background to the situation. And I found it strange, why would a Minister for Finance, who is at pains to say he is separate from any NAMA commercial decisions and is prohibited from doing so, be here in front of the PAC detailing context for us? He spoke of how the impaired loans were a drag on Ireland and its ability to re-enter the bond market. And at that point, he swivelled in his chair and he pointed towards the CNAG and he said, you didn't have the ECB or the Troika breathing down your neck. Unbelievable stuff. It equated to an attack on him. And this is the Minister for Finance giving context. So my first question is, given those statements, did you have the Minister for Finance, Michael Noonan, breathing down your neck? And did he influence, pressurise or even suggest that you get this done as quickly as possible and get it in the bag?
We were brought under no pressure to sell it in connection with Project Eagle. What the Minister said to you and what he was saying to us, it is important from Ireland's point of view, Ireland Inc. and its borrowings, that the debt is paid down by NAMA as quickly as possible. The Act, in fact, asked us to deal with the assets expeditiously. Twice in Section 10, the word expeditiously is used. And there were three things when he spoke to the board that I can recall the Minister saying. One was, you know, where you have the opportunity, pay down the debt as quickly as possible. Secondly, I want you to see what you can do to deliver housing. And as a result of that, we developed a programme of 20,000 houses by 2020, which was a huge increase for us. We had an aim up to then of 1,500 a year. Now we had to push it to 4,000 per annum on average. And the third point he made then was, you know, in relation to the Docklands and the SDZ there, that we needed commercial development there and housing and, you know, to work with the agencies involved, apart from ourselves, to deliver there. So he spoke to us, just to finish, on general terms about paying down the debt.
Okay. Well, that's interesting now, because again, then I'll say, because he had a number of people from the Department of Finance here with him on that day as well. I think he had the second secretary as well, who's coming back in before us as well. And did they convey to you in terms of, they say they have regular contact? Because obviously that would, someone could say that wouldn't be political pressure because it's the officials. And interestingly, on the day, I think it was Anne Nolan, said that there was no other deal really on the table. And this was the Department of Finance talking. I mean, they were effectively very good cheerleaders, I have to say, for the stance that NAMA took, because they were full behind you on that particular day. So again, I'll ask you, with the Department of Finance senior officials saying, yes, get this done as quickly as possible, because you say back to me that the Act refers to expeditiously. How expeditiously and at what cost? Because that is obviously the kernel of what we're chasing. At what cost?
Can I just refer, actually, so it was only in probably once a year that we would have met with the Minister of Finance, and I don't think I, as a board member, would have ever met with anybody. Actually, I think I met maybe Anne Nolan once. And as a consequence, I, as a board member, didn't ever, quite frankly, have any interaction with the Department of Finance or the Minister where they were saying, you should do this or do that. It was once a year with the Minister. The Minister would come to a strategy session. And as Willie has said, they were the areas that he would have asked us. Other than that, for us, actually, quite frankly, Deputy, we didn't have interactions with the Minister or with the Department of Finance. Okay. I think that's fair.
Well, I can say the same. There usually was interaction at chairman level with finance, but I had no interaction with finance.
And I suppose that's, Chairman, dealing with the minuted accounts of meetings and so forth, or non-minute. I mean, this is obviously, in terms of then even personal interaction, meeting in any other kind of context, was there ever a conversation between you or him or any of the senior officials about expeditiously moving this on?
That would be anyway.
No, not me. Mm-hmm. I
Mr. Soff, you did say to us before the break that there was no political pressure, but that what was required was a discreet and confidential process. Who said that to you?
That was conveyed to the chairman, as I understand it, from the minister, and discussions that had been had with the minister's counterpart in Northern Ireland.
So that goes right back to the heart of what I said. So there was no political pressure, but the minister said to you he wanted a discreet and confidential process.
What he said was that it's up to you to run the sales process. But, you know, in the interests of Northern Ireland and the particular problems that they were always dealing with, can you do this in a discreet manner?
I understand that, but that goes back to the heart of what I'm saying, that we had a Minister for Finance in here saying that he had absolutely nothing got to do with this process. He was fully removed from it, but at the same time, he was suggesting, advising, saying he wanted a discreet and confidential process, given that it was Northern Ireland. Does that not go against the grain of that whole issue of transparency that is at the heart of this discussion?
Well, I think what he was saying to us, really, you need, you know, this is an opportunity to have a time-bound, limited process. But at no stage did he advise against a competitive process. The minister always made it clear in any discussions he had elsewhere or in contacts he had with us was it was NAMA's policy was open competition, and he was never advising us to change that.
Again, he saw that as an opportunity, but the CNAG report refers to the fact that the probable losses by virtue of the pursuance of that tactic, of that option.
We have a problem with it.
I know you do. I know you do.
That's probable what loss, because we don't believe that phrase stands up at all. There's no loss, as I said.
Okay, but given again, just in terms of the Minister of Finance's role in this, and you said that he saw a discreet and confidential process, and in your statement, you do say that given the recent history of this island, it would have been unthinkable for NAMA to have ignored the impact of its actions on the Northern Ireland economy and on North-South relations. Again, just it comes back to the issue of motivation, and does that thinking give rise to your mind in terms of applying, in terms of the process, how expeditiously it was proceeded with, and the discount that was applied?
I don't think there's any problem with for any organisation in taking a decision to take account of all factors, and the political factors in both here and in Northern Ireland were one of the factors that we bore in mind when we were looking to...
It does if the Minister for Finance is trying to seek to have this wrapped up and it results in a probable loss to the state, because that ultimately is what's being...
Let's do it in parts. That the whole series of factors came into the reason as to why we looked at selling this. Somebody came forward to buy it. At the time, we thought that there was no single party interested in buying the lot. Fact. We then had the political forces saying, if you do decide to sell these assets, please, it would be unhelpful to have Northern Ireland hawked around by a state agency here in the south. Fine. We then said, OK, our policy is we don't have closed sales, so everything has to go to some kind of competitive process. So we then said, right, we need as competitive a process as can be had for one this size, and two, with the request that these aren't hawked around on the front page of the Irish Times. And that's where we are. At no point were we ever asked to sell these assets at below our Section 10 price, and I think it's really important that people bear in mind we had a view in our mind as to what was the number that we could sell these assets for and keep faith with our Section 10 obligation. And that in our mind was this 1.3 billion sterling number.
Okay. And if we fail to reach that minimum price, no matter who was talking to us, we wouldn't have sold.
That's true. But what I just can't, and I'm coming back to this point, Chairman, what I just can't, I think it's find it unbelievable, is that we did have a Minister for Finance, as you said, Mr. Soff, he was the person who said to you, in terms of that advice of a discreet and confidential process, who was giving no end of advice to people on how to proceed, saying he had no role in the in this commercial deal. And at the same time when he came before us and I asked him a straight question as to whether he believed then there was a good deal or not, said, no, well, I'm not going to comment on that. But he was advising in terms of actually progressing this deal, but can't then make an adjudication as the Minister for Finance for this country as to whether there was a problem with
that. But I think that
it's up to NAMA to decide whether it was a good deal or not.
You know, and he was categorically, in our view, we were not being advised by the Finance Minister. He was airing a view as to what the political will was in both parts of Ireland.
And Europe.
Because he kept referring to the ECB and Troika as well.
And that if we found a way of selling these assets, that would be fine. But we didn't take advice from the Finance Minister. I mean, he could have directed
us. So you've got no sense that he was under an extreme amount of pressure from Europe and that he was implying and imparting on this pressure to you to do this? None whatsoever.
The pressure he was under was because of financial events for Ireland as a whole to try and pay down the debt as quickly as possible to get the contingent liability off the state balance sheet so that it could start refinancing and not have a second bailout. So that would have been at the back of his mind, but it wasn't of...
Take that... forefront of his mind, given his comments to the CNAG the last day, yeah?
Right. Then what he wasn't then doing was saying, take this pot of assets and sell them. That was down to us.
But I recall that when we were early on in the first few years, when we had this target of 7.5 billion euro to pay back, and it was touch and go whether we were going to achieve that by the end of 2013. The chief executive officer of the NTMA, who was on the board of NAMA, was saying, you know, if we don't reach this target, this will be damaging to the sovereign. And I'm trying to borrow to fund, the expenditure in this country. I mean, if you look back, part of the cost of the services in the last 10 budgets has been met by borrowing. So it was important that the state be able to borrow at the lowest rate possible.
I'm not disputing that. We're just trying to ascertain in terms of the process that you followed and in terms of the ultimate price. I mean, no one's politicians of all people don't need a history lesson in terms of how the state was funded over that period
of time. I'm emphasising how important it was that the debt be paid down for the reputation of the country.
Certainly. And the point that we're trying to extract is at what cost? And was there a cause? Well, that's the whole point.
What I'm saying,
in terms of the interjection between us all.
As far as we were concerned, at fair market-related price. That's what we were saying.
That's the point you were making. So going back to the rationale of why the discount of 10% was applied, and you brought up on screen your financial statement of 2013, which, as the chairman had clarified earlier, was signed in May of 2014, are you able to categorically state that you do have sound documentary evidence, real-time, not post-dated stamp time, from the board, where the considerations that you're speaking about were thrashed out and the resolutions arrived at that documents that?
Yes, absolutely.
As part of our decision-making, Deputy, we absolutely reflected the fact, and I think it is so important to say, you know, and I know it possibly annoys the chairman, but we set our target price based upon cash flows that we were doing for the year end, and then we discounted them back, and that's where we came up with our 1.3 billion. And we said if we didn't get a price of £1.3 billion, we weren't going to sell the portfolio. And what is important is, how did we come to that? We considered a number of factors. Considered, if you took your cash flows, and what is important is that there's no disagreement between the CNAG and NAMA in relation to the cash flows out to 2020. What is the issue at heart is, if you were to say, if they were out to 2020 and you discounted them back to today, CNAG has calculated the 190 million based on using a 5.5% discount factor. We said you wouldn't be able to sell these assets on a 5.5 discount, and because even much, much, much better assets that were fully performing, remember now that many of these were non-performing, we're coming at a discount factor of 7.5%. So that was our contention, is that you couldn't have sold. Which goes back, Chairman, to this: to have a seller, you have to have a purchaser.
Sorry, Chair, I just wanted to make the point that that actually wasn't what the CNAG was saying. He wasn't saying that if we had a loan strategy that the 5.5% discount rate would be applied. He was talking about, and my understanding is that it was based on the debtor, on the asset sales strategy, and not on a loan sale. Is that correct?
Mr. McKenna, come in. I won't bring in the CNAG.
No, the 190 million that the CNAG said is the 1.49 million versus the 1.3. In actual fact, we got 1.32. But that's how the 190 million, to my mind, is calculated, by virtue of the fact that the CNAG has discounted the future value of the cash flows that both he and we agreed on. At the end of December 2013, we both agreed on. He signed off on the financial statement. So those, we're both at ad idem in that. What then happened is that we said that this is not a realistic. That was one factor. Another factor that we considered was, we said, if you discounted the cash flows, even using the 5.5%, because the 5.5% is in our paper, then another way that you would say, if you were a purchaser, like NAMA did, when NAMA acquired these loans from the participating institutions back in 2009, do you remember this long-term economic value uplift? What we deducted off of that was a cost for enforcement, a cost to carry, for us, our carrying costs into the future around these loans. So we took off a discount. So there was an uplift, the long-term economic value, and then when we bought those loans, we put a discount to reflect the fact that we would have enforcement costs. So we also said in that paper back in December of 2013 that a purchaser would not buy these if they didn't put in a discount. And that's the 10% that is referred to inside on the last page of that paper. So we approached it, Deputy, on a number of fronts to come to that 1.3 billion. It wasn't as if we came up and willy-nilly looked at that. And I know you're not saying that. We didn't, though. We looked at it on a few fronts. We looked at the cash flows. We discounted them using a low market-based. Remember, in the reports of the, what were the discount factors, some of them which have been given as part, there was ranges of 11 to 19% is what the Department of Finance said back.
All I asked was just in terms of actually accounts of where that was trashed out. You've just simply referred to the, to the financial statement of 2013.
We did
trash it out.
I think what is terribly important is that we do say it to you.
Because the one thing that the CNAG has said is that the lack of documentary evidence is not helpful either in this process in terms of actually allowing people
And do you know what? And I mean, in truth, that the CNAG has said that. Mm-hmm. And the fact is that if there was anything that we take, as chairman of the audit committee, I'd love to sit down now to see an AG and say, well, what? Because remember, we produced minutes between 2009 and 2016, and that's the form. It has been mostly deputy on the basis of, like, it does say, for instance, there were discussions around this inside in our minutes, but mostly our minutes are formed on the basis of the decision. The CNAG, quite frankly, has never questioned our minutes before, as around up until this section, this report. So back in previous, in 2010, 11, 12, 13, never said, your minutes are too short, because ultimately minutes are part of record keeping. We accept that. We record decisions. I will, however, I'll gladly take it from here on that I have a discussion with the Comptroller and Auditor General around minute taking into the future, because but still, I think we should have that discussion. He's now said it in this report, but he hadn't previously said it.
Given just from the own point of view, from the context of the sensitivity, as you have rightly said in your own language, of what was being handled to make sure that there was an accurate recording, and especially given in the financial statement, you say that you were going to allow yourself that wriggle room to change the discount, given that if you wanted to actually move a deal on, that there wouldn't be proper minute-taking of a decision such as this magnitude?
I thought it was important to bring it to the attention. And I do note the Chairman's points about us being able to show that this was something that was contemplated before the sale occurred. I fully accept that. I think we'll revert on that. But I think it is important for us to outline, as part of that, that what was said here on the last occasion by the CNAG, I think is not fully correct, because he said the 10% only came into the equation last June. It didn't. It was inside in our financial statements.
Deputy Kelly did ask earlier in terms of actually a time frame for actually just producing some of that documentation. I don't know if that was fully answered.
It'd
be my objective to go back from here and to ask for that, because I think that's a very reasonable.
I'll be saying to the chairman in the next 48 hours, we need this now, and we need a weekly response to every request from now on, because 3 weeks of it's unbelievable. So we've made the point.
One of the problems.
3 weeks ago. No, but and you can take this message back, and I'm sure Hammer watching. If there's a place, we had a list of 20 items. If there's an issue in one or two of them being released, give us the rest of them. You know, can get working and studying.
That's but there is a legal issue, as you know.
On some of them.
Yeah.
Not them all. Deputy, are we nearly done?
Yeah,
Deputy Edward.
Thank you, Chairman. And those that I must say too, like my colleagues, I find it unbelievable the open statement of Mr. Scott today, or Mr. Soft today, in the way he attacked the Office of Attorney General, Controller and Auditor General, because I thought when three members of the board, the only seven members of it, would come in here to defend themselves and defend the reasons of this sport, this sale, this whole sale of Eagle. Portfolio Eagle. And instead of that, he came in and he attacked the Controller and Auditor General, which I find unbelievable. You know, I find if you were going to come in here as board members, it's in here defending the reason for all this and why this has went through and why we have it here in front of, not attack another pillar of the government and try to downgrade them and rubbish what they said.
I don't accept that we made any sort of a personal attack. I think what we did, trenchantly, I accept, was defend our position and why we thought that we had taken right courses of action. I don't think that is offensive. That you, if you feel you're right, that you shouldn't say you're right and the reasons for why you're saying it. And that's all we have done. I mean,
one way to come down and downgrade him and rubbish him is another thing.
But I don't think we've done that. We have disagreed and said we strongly disagree with some of his conclusions. But I mean, as I said earlier, we worked with auditors most of our lives, and you know, you have disagreements, and if you have disagreements, you air them.
You respect his office.
Yes.
Can I think
very much.
I think, Chairman, we said that we've gained a lot from the interactions with CNAG since 2009. I think that's it would be wrong of us not to say that, and to be absolutely fully acknowledging of the fact that CNAG has been part of the journey of the National Asset Management Agency in its systems development and its improvement. What I think my colleague is saying is, and I'm an accountant, I believe there are aspects of the report and the methodologies around the report which I think, quite frankly, I would have gone about differently. If I would, for instance, have met the individuals, the board members, and because the CNAG alludes inside in his report and his submission on the 29th of September that he had to rely on the minutes. Well, he didn't, because verbal evidence and oral there was only seven of us. He could have met us.
Established in 2014, delays had been up to 4.5 years. And in a recent assessment by a law lecturer in Maynooth, despite work that has been underway, he estimates that at the rate of progress, it will take about 11 years, for that backlog to be cleared. Now, Chief Justice Denham and the President of the Court of Appeal, Sean Ryan, have appealed to government to fill vacancies to the Court of Appeal. We know there are vacancies in the Supreme Court and the various other courts, district, circuit, that have not been appointed. Now, it is said that the Independent Alliance have frozen the appointment of any new judges as a core principle pending the enactment of the Judicial Appointments Bill. That, in my view, is unacceptable. You indicated, Taoiseach, that that was not the case, but a subsequent spokesman, after you indicated to, I think, the Labour Party had raised it, said there would be no appointments until the Judicial Appointments Bill had passed through the House. Now, it's a very serious issue, Taoiseach, because victims of crime deserve to have their cases heard and deserve to have justice achieved. And it's the government essentially, through this paralysis that's been caused by the Independent Alliance and the weakness of the other side of government to face up to it, is essentially traversing and interfering with the constitutional rights of citizens to have justice achieved. It's a very basic thing in a democracy. And is it the case that we're to have no judges appointed until government gets around to passing the necessary legislation? It's unacceptable, Taoiseach. And I will put it to you that any government that's incapable of appointing judges, is a dysfunctional government. And you need to rectify that, Taoiseach, very, very quickly indeed. So, Taoiseach, can you indicate that it is the government's intention to appoint judges forthwith, and that the opposition of the Independent Alliance will not be allowed hold sway until the government's bill is published?
Thank you, Deputy Martin. Taoiseach.
Well, you're certainly correct when you say justice delayed is justice denied. I'd make the point to you, Deputy Martin, that when I was elected Taoiseach in the first instance, the delay in getting cases into the Supreme Court was over 3 years. And there was a huge backlog right across the entire spectrum of the judicial courts. One of the issues that arose was that there should be a Court of Appeal set up to deal with cases that the High Court would have dealt with, but that should not go directly to the Supreme Court because of the delays there, but that would be, it would be sent instead to the Court of Appeal to make a decision. And that took some time to set that up, and that was set up and began to work very effectively. Now, as I understand it, and I don't have the figures in front of me, Deputy Martin, I think the number of judicial vacancies is very small at the moment in all of the courts. Now, I may be wrong, and you may have different information. I don't obviously engage with members of the judiciary on a regular basis, for very good reason. So, as I understand it, the number of vacancies in the, of judicial appointments are very small, and you're aware of the process that has been followed for very many years. Now, the Thánaiste has set out her views in respect of putting together the Judicial Appointments Commission. That has been responded to by the Parliamentary Draftsman's Office, and as I understand it, has been sent to the Department of Justice. But also understand that coming from the Court of Appeal is a request that there be a further subsection set up in the Court of Appeal, which would require, I'm not sure how many judges. And this is not what was intended. And far be it from me to say that the learned members of the bench are not able to do the job, which they are. The intention in setting up the Court of Appeal was to not have to have so many cases lying for years before they would be dealt with by the Supreme Court. So it's not true to say that no judges can be appointed. It's not true to say that no judges will be appointed. The legislation is being proceeded with to draft in conclusion and will be brought in here. But clearly, Deputy Martin, I'm quite sure that if it was absolutely necessary to make a judicial appointment or judicial appointments, then that would happen. But as I understand it now from some weeks ago, the number are actually very small, and they are not in the Court of Appeal, as far as I can recall. It might have a district court or circuit court or whatever else. But I'll check the figures, and I'll advise Deputy Martin of what it actually means now. That's different than a request to set up a new subsection of the Court of Appeal dealing with X number of judges.
Thank you very much, Deputy Martin. Could take over. That's Seth Barrett-Tillman, law lecturer in Maynooth. And I understand, and you can confirm whether this has happened or not, that the Chief Justice and the President of the High Court have actually approached the government with a view to the appointment of more judges to the Court of Appeal. But either that has happened or it hasn't happened. And you didn't answer my question. Is it the case that the Independent Alliance has said no more judges can be appointed until the Judicial Appointments Commission is established? Yes or no? Is that the actual position as we speak? Because that's what we're being told week after week via the media, that the Independent Alliance have frozen any more judicial appointments. Now, Deputy Jim McCallan has actually and will be publishing the actual legislation that's required today. Now, the Independent Alliance know all about it, because Deputy Callan, who's kind of a learned man in this domain, enlightened the Independent Alliance during the formation talks at the time. And I suspect that members of the Alliance have taken a lot of these lessons on board. We didn't think they'd take them as enthusiastically on board as they currently are now in freezing and paralysing the appointment of judges. But that legislation will be there and can be adopted by government. But answer the question, Taoiseach, is the Independent Alliance saying no more new judges? And is the government acquiescing to that? And if that is the case, that's dysfunctional, Taoiseach. Deputy Martin Taoiseach.
No, the Independent Alliance have not attempted to put down their foot and say that no more judges should be appointed. When the last number of judges were appointed, the intention was that they might be the last appointed under the old system, but that the new legislation would come through. But that's not from the Independent Alliance. That is not from the Independent Alliance. Let me say to you, if your information is as accurate as you say that as you portray to me, how many vacancies are in the Court of Appeal now? Yeah, but they're not five vacancies, as I understand it, on the Court of Appeal. That is for a new subset of the Court of Appeal to hear different cases, which is a different matter. The fact of the matter is, Deputy Martin, that what we inherited here was a system that was not working effectively. And the judiciary themselves said, what you must do to clear this is fill the district court, the circuit court, the high court and the Supreme Court, and you need to set up a court of appeal. That's what the previous government did, and it filled that with a very good president and filled it with all the numbers that were due. And because of the number of cases that then moved through the High Court, after the Court of Appeal, you now have a backlog built up here. And the judiciary will quite rightly say we need more judges in here to deal with these cases. I'll check Martin, the numbers that are vacant, Deputy Martin, please. And I will advise you this afternoon.
Thank you very much, Deputy.
It's not true. The
Deputy Gerry Adams, please. Deputy Gerry Adams has the floor.
Wait now.
Excuse me, Deputy. Please, we're not here to conduct a conversation. Please, Deputy Adams has the floor.
Later this week, Taoiseach, you'll attend a meeting of the European Council, and it's the first EU summit since the British Prime Minister Theresa May announced to the Tory party conference that she will trigger Article 50.